Right, welcome back to the show. And of course, Urban Today gets on the timeline. Could be right here in your hands, on your phone, or even on your PC. We get to find a way of letting you know on what has been making trades or trending on social media. Joining me, of course, is the hashtag Doc himself. Good morning to you, well,
good morning, how are you?
Not bad.
How is your morning?
Very fantastic. I admit it, it's
what's,
a very good day.
What's fantastic about your morning?
The fact that I'm alive, kicking. The Prime Minister is coming in from India, and the fact that I'm drinking some coffee.
Yeah, and of course, some roads have been closed off around Kololo area.
No, it's okay. Yeah. It is understandable.
It's
for
Indian community
security purposes in the nation. Yeah, we are trying to make sure that the Prime Minister
feels
at home.
You sound like a security guy.
I admit it.
Yeah.
That's the hashtag, by the way, for today. I admit it.
Anyway, what's trending online?
Yes.
I picked up a tweet from Charles Onyango Bo, and it says, Ethiopia and Eritrea set for the first football match in 20 years. The two nations have avoided games against each other since the start of the border war in 1998.
What does this mean for these two nations? A couple of weeks ago, planes are flying each other's countries. Now the games.
Yeah.
You know?
It's reconciliation. It's good news. Just imagine Uganda and Rwanda having played football in 20
In 20 years.
That tension is, it will be really, really rough for us. But, you know, Ethiopia and Eritrea are going to be playing that match. And it's going to be historical.
Okay.
And someone tweeted there and said that it should be a draw to avoid
to avoid another cold war that could spark off.
Yes, it should be a draw. You know, let's probably just agree. If Eritrea scores, let's give chance for their guys to also score. If it goes the other way around,
but I think it's a fair deal. You know,
it's a fair deal. Going to happen after 20 years. You know, these guys are reconciling, it's step by step, but I believe they're headed for the right direction.
I think after that, they should go into intermarriages, you know, Eritrea,
you
Ethiopia.
You
I'm just saying, because daily at the end of the day, we are reconciling, you know, in intermarriages. Imagine an Eritrean woman with an Ethiopian man.
And with your looks,
that would be
you kind of confuse someone for Eritrea.
I mean, I'm both there. I am the intermarriage product.
You're the chief.
Moving away from that, there was an interesting one coming in here from Grace.
Grace Natavaro.
Yes.
Grace Natavaro asked a very interesting question. It's one of those questions we take lightly. When someone asks you about rent, you know, they lightly ask you, and you take it lightly. We don't really go deep into it. But it's something that we people, you know, that don't own our own mansions and houses, need to think about, you know. And she says, UOT, Ugandans on Twitter, what's the average rent, you know, that people pay for a two-bedroom house in Kampala?
Yes.
Now, if you take it literally the way it is, you'd be like, 300, and, you know, you'd go on. But it's a little deeper than that. You know, different places, you know,
the security
require different amounts of, you know, rent. Places closer to the main road, places deep inside, you know, places in, let's say, Namuongo, or maybe Chira, or maybe Mkoto. That, you know, different prices for different houses depending on your requirements as an individual.
Yes.
And people started, you know, jumping onto the conversation. Alan Senyonga said 350k, and then Grace comes on in Kampala or
Mukono. Mukono.
Of course, still depends on whether there is enough security
distance
from the main road, etc. But I think, you know, the minimum one can get for it is, he didn't mention the price. Then you may have to define two bedroom, include the number of bathrooms, kitchen, living room, and other things.
Okay.
Yeah, so if you want a two-room house, how do you want it?
Mm-hmm.
Do you want just a two-room house so you can shower on the veranda? Do you want a two-room house so you can, you know, shower outside the bathroom?
Or cook from outside?
Yeah, you understand. So you need to define, when you're looking for a house, you need to define to the, you know, broker what kind of house you want exactly. And then someone says, don't stress, you know, cross to Nansana, two-bedroom houses with security is at 350K. I was shocked with this. You know, two-bedroom house, 350K with security.
That's cheap.
Yeah, Nigeria is 500K.
That is for the single bedroom.
Yes, for
so
a single bedroom.
I mean, you can see,
you,
yeah? Nigeria and Nansana. Nansana,
sneaky na mriya amanyo. And you see, that's the problem. People in Nigeria think that it's classy to pay more for rent.
But they feel like they have made it.
At 150K less, probably in Muyenga.
So what are you saying about Muyenga and Nigeria people?
I'm just saying that it's a lot more expensive to live in Nigeria for no good reason.
Bearing in mind that traffic jam that is always there between 6, 7 a.m. up to like about 11 a.m.
Yeah, when you're looking for a house, you need to look out for the traffic. If you're a guy who works in the city, you need to look out for traffic. Probably places that come use traffic routes of Makindye and... you know, those, you know, have a lot of traffic, so places there will be cheaper because of the traffic.
Do we still have places where we don't have traffic jam?
Yes.
Right, I feel like Ugandans have bought a lot of cars.
There's good traffic for me when I'm coming in the morning. But people in Tinda, Bukoto, the houses are a little cheaper because the traffic is, you know, too high. Yeah, so you need to look out for traffic and the road security and, you know, exactly where you're going to be getting a house. Also, but here would probably be
not these know. Things of getting an Uber and then when you reach somewhere it tells you I'm park or half hours.
So you need to look out for, first of all, if you're looking for a house, you need to look out for a good broker. Some brokers are going to make you work for a full month and get you nothing. Other brokers will not even take your money, but, you know, get you something and then you pay later. But these guys will come to you and say, first give me 50k before I even show you what I have. Yeah, you need to. Then someone says above 600k, another says an average of 500k, another says 600 to 800k, two bedroom in Chiwatule.
That must have been like in Tebe.
700k. I don't know where these guys live.
700k? 700k? To 1.5? Buziga, anyway. That's Buziga for
700k to 1.5 in Buziga. Then it depends on the location. If you are on average, not based on location, you could get skewed results because majority of them are in Chivuli, Nakulabye, Waise, Kazo, Katanga. I think people in Waise need to.
Yeah, but you see, you don't have to stress if the income is not that good. Just here in Katanga, 150k, two bedroomed house with a with a toilet just behind you. They give you a key. Chino chetsumuzocha toilet. You lose it, I'm telling you. You contemplate on whether to call the landlord or to just shift without her knowing.
But on average, if I may ask you, which places do you think that, you know, someone could comfortably live and pay a comfortable amount for rent?
I think Ntinda, Bukoto would be very okay. Kisasi, Kulambiro is okay. A little bit of Najera. That is, if you don't get to Najera 2, looking into the distance bit of it. Najera 1 and... actually, Mutungo is good as well. Mutungo, you can get good houses at about, 350,000, Ruzila side. And then, of course, if you get into the areas of Buziga and Munyonya and Muyenga, now you have gone into another whole, you know, level again. But
in my own view, I would advise someone to step out of town a bit.
Step out of town?
Yeah, step out of town. Get to areas of Sonde, Sonde, get to areas of...
convenience of accessing town. When you want to access town at a very short period of time.
Out of town, you start your week comfortable.
No. I'm looking at the pressure beat when you're starting the week.
And every time you're sleeping, there's someone hooting, there's a border
accident. When I mean in Tinda, I don't say Ugand rent on the main road. Yeah?
Minister's village.
Deep down dozens.
Are there houses in
there are some houses. If you look wisely, with a good broker, you will find the house, I'm telling you.
I'm going to be in touch with you. Anyway, the biggest story that is yet to catch on Ugandan Twitter, you OTs are about to start talking about this, is the R. Kelly 19-minute song that he just released. It has caused a lot of talk, a lot of backlash. Spotify and iTunes have taken the song off their platforms.
Yes.
International media has jumped on it. And he tweeted and said, today is the day, you know, you've been waiting for. I admit it. Listen. Boom. People started.
SoundCloud.
Yeah. If you listen to the song, you were listening.
Yes, I was listening to it.
Just before we went on air. And he's admitting to, you know, mistakes he's made over the time. Yes. You know, just like any other human being, he's had flaws, he's had this, he's done that. And in there, he's saying that, you know, I admit I had a few women, but why would you call that, you know?
He talks about the young, old women.
Yes, that he says we call him a pedophile. What kind of stuff is that? And
so, why would he admit to only the negative things? I've not had him admit to any positive things.
He admitted, you know, I don't go to church. He admitted I write my own music. I do all sorts of things.
All that is negative.
Yeah, that's positive. He writes his own music. So he's sort of trying to say, I think, in my own view, he's trying to say, I'm done. It's 50 plus.
Does this song give us a whole different image of who R. Kelly we knew in our head?
It really doesn't. It just reaffirms what, you know, has been in our minds. Did he, you know, molest those kids? Did he send that nude picture to that 17-year-old? Mm. Did he do all these things? So this is just, you know, a reaffirmation.
So he is as bad as he could be in this song.
Yeah, most people are saying that this song should actually be, you know, submitted into evidence because it's him singing about himself and he's admitting to all sorts of, you know, things in there.
Mm.
But he actually came out and said that, you know, he still says he's innocent of the charges, you know, that have been put against him. He also says, you know, contrary to the song, he maintains that he's not guilty of the numerous, you know, sex crimes. He sings about, I did it. It reminds the public, you know, of the atrocities, of the things that, you know, people have been accusing him of. And some of the tweets come through.
Yes.
Apparently, R. Kelly thinks you can just sing away misogyny and abuse, targeting teenage girls, illegally furnishing drugs and alcohol, recording sex acts without consent, and spreading hippies, you know, just doesn't have melodic ring to it. So people are really, you know,
I see they're giving him a test of his own medicine.
But I believe that, you know, we should go to, these cases should be reopened.
I feel like,
because this is a different twist to it. It's someone who says,
why would he even release such a track admitting to all that he has done?
In one's career, you know, just days before someone tweeted.
But this could lead to his biggest downfall. This is actually the beginning of his downfall.
Probably.
Is this what he wanted?
The famous people are actually the most, you know, haunted people.
Mm.
They have haunted lives. They're never peaceful. They have a lot of drama, you know, in their personal life. So probably this would be one of the signs that
R. Kelly Ali MBM wins. Let me tell you, we all have those secrets that we are supposed to carry with to the grave. It is the discussion is going to be between you, your ancestors, and God, the three of you.
Yes.
But these things of wanting to admit things. So what next now?
And I believe that in probably 20 years from now, we'll get a song from Bebe Cool
admitting,
you know, not admitting because I've seen the videos, talking about what happened to him when he was carrying those young girls on stage.
Mm.
Yes, we've seen the videos of this thing happening. Ziza Bafana had
entertainment.
Ziza Bafana, Natty Nathan. These things will come back to you when you're 55, 60, and you're thinking back to the life you've led and saying, "What did I do?" So, I think that's the phase that R. Kelly is going through. You know, Martin Lawrence had the same phase when he undressed and ran across the street, and you know all these things. So it happens in, you know, someone's career.
Did Michael Jackson ever have a moment of confessing and admitting why he did all the acts that he did?
Michael Jackson's is a different case.
Really?
It's a different
case. Because I could put Kelly and MJ in the same box.
No, I can't. MJ is on another level.
Okay. Legendary-wise, yes. But act-wise, I would put them in the same box and even close it and throw away the key.
Maybe MJ was a little worse.
Was he?
Because R. Kelly was you know, there's a time R. Kelly was on stage. He got a fan's phone and you know, massaged it on his, you know, private parts and gave it to them. Then a time when he got a towel, rubbed it around and convinced a revealer to just use it on the face. So all these things come back to you and haunt you.
I bring them back to the fans. Stop being so obsessed with these people. At the end of the day, they are just humans. R. Kelly does, you know, go for number two and, you know, makes those funny faces as well.
It's tricky. But other than that, Young Achievers Awards is born. And of course, at, you know, Urban TV, we are also doing 25 under 25. So be a part of it. And let's have fun.
All right.